Special shout out to Tesla for making this video possible, the must-have companion app for any Tesla owner. I have been waiting 2 years for my Tesla Powerwall, and now I finally have it installed. I've had it for about a month. I've had a chance to use it, to understand all the different settings and the properties. And in this episode, I want to talk to you about everything you need to know about the Powerwall. First and foremost, when you buy the Powerwall and you have it installed, I want to walk you through what you can expect. First, all of your electricity for your house runs from a service panel. In this panel, you have electricity being provided from your utility company on the street. And in this panel, you have different circuits or different junctions. And the reason is because there's a limit to how much power you can draw from copper wire. So to spread that out and make sure that you're not having a microwave and a hairdryer constantly overloading each circuit, you break out your house into different circuits. Why does this matter? Because when Tesla comes with their Powerwall, they're going to create a new sub-panel. They call it the critical loads panel. The idea here really is to back up everything that you can with your Powerwall. Depending on how many Powerwalls you have, that will determine how much you can back up. So for me, I have one Powerwall. As a result, my air conditioning, my double oven, and my Tesla car charging is not backed up. Those are over 30 amp loads, but everything else in my house is. If you have two or three, maybe you can back up your air conditioning, maybe you can back up your double ovens and things like that. Talk to your reps at Tesla to ask those questions and get clarity on that. So step one, they'll come in and they'll pull all these circuits out of your main panel. So my main panel was really busy before, now it's almost entirely empty because all that's left are the things that are not backed up. From here, you have a gateway that is also installed. Now, this is where Tesla's incredible eye for detail and their gorgeous products really shines. This, typically in most companies, the gateway is an ugly black box made of plastic or steel. This is white and it is glass. But in this gateway lives the heart of the internet connected device, which knows what's going on as far as how much power your house is using. It makes the judgment of detecting the grid and when the grid goes out to switch to the power wall. This happens instantly. You'll see the light flicker for like a little bit, but otherwise computers don't shut down, nothing happens. All of our desktops carried on, nothing crashed or anything else. My power wall is a gorgeous candy apple red, and other than that aesthetic look, it's identical to every other power wall. The Powerwall has 13.5 kilowatt hours of storage capacity. Now, I thought this was a lot, but here in July and August in San Diego, I'm running my air conditioning, and turns out 13.5 isn't as much as I thought because it can't power my house through the entire night. But if my air conditioning wasn't running, that could actually be enough to power me till the next day when the sun comes back up again. Now that brings up the solar portion. And by the way, if you're considering going Tesla solar or Powerwall and you wanna save $100 and help support the show, consider using our link. It would help us out. And we're hoping to get future invitations to Tesla events. So thank you so much for your support as always. So you have the option of either going solar and Powerwall or just Powerwall. And that will change a couple of things. For one, I already had solar. So when the Powerwall came in, they took the solar leg coming into my service panel and they run it into what Tesla will monitor and record and feed into the Powerwall when there's excess energy. If you don't have solar, then you can actually have your Powerwall charge from the grid. Now this might vary from utility to utility, so talk to your Tesla rep. They'll know the rules in your region to help answer that question. All right, next up, let's hop into the mobile application. Inside of it, you've probably seen your car in the past, but now if you swipe to the right, you'll see your Powerwall. So first up, we have power flow. So power flow is showing you what is happening right now. 3.2 kilowatts is what my solar is producing, and what it is doing is it's powering the house, and then whatever's left is charging the Powerwall. In the performance section, it shows you how much of your power was from solar or the Powerwall. So today, only about 5%, not very good, but it will get better later in the day. The backup history will show you when the power outages have occurred and for how long. So you can always check in here and go, oh, interesting, the power went out, but I didn't even know because I have a Powerwall. And finally, the most interesting part is under Customize. Here you have all your different options. If you want the Powerwall only to just be fully charged in the event of an emergency, you'd put it in backup only. But that's not very interesting. There's better options. Second is self-powered. What that means is when the sun is shining and you're making too much, it'll charge the battery. And when you need a little bit more, it'll discharge the battery. Simply put, it will try its best to never use the grid. Next up is advanced, and this is where you want to be if you have time of use. Here in San Diego, we have different billing based on time of day. The most expensive is 4 to 9 p.m. at 50 cents, and midnight to 6 a.m. for me is 9 cents for charging things like my car. So if you put it in balance, what it'll do is it'll try to power the house and then charge the Powerwall as best as it can. If you choose cost-saving mode, then the Powerwall will charge up as fast as it can and it'll wait until the time you specify for when the prices are really high. So here you can edit the prices and you notice that I've got 4 to 11:30 as my peak time. Even though it's 4 to 9, I have the Powerwall just go ahead and power whatever it can until it runs out of energy after 4 p.m. So down below we have storm watch, which means that the Tesla is monitoring. If you live in like Florida and you have hurricanes and things, it'll monitor for events that could cause power disruptions and it'll be prepared for that. And you even have an option to charge your vehicle even if the power goes out to a certain amount. So we've spent a lot of time in the Tesla app, and as amazing as it is, there's one other must-have app that I use all the time for my Tesla, and that is the Tesla app. Here's why the Tesla app is so amazing. In track, you can see every trip you have taken on your Tesla, every time you start and stop it. And it tells you how far you drove and how efficient you were. If you're a business professional and you drive for work, this is the killer application feature for me. With one click, you can export, bring it into a spreadsheet, and track which was for business, which was not, and have exact mileage figures. It also tells you your battery scores and how your battery is performing over time and how much range you're getting, the levels of degradation and performance. And there's even a leaderboard and a community element that really gamifies the entire experience, as if driving a Tesla wasn't fun enough already. So if you want to have the must-have Tesla app for your car, go to teslab.app/2bit. Signing up is free, and if you want the longer-term data of the Pro app, then that cost about as much as a cup of coffee a month. So that's the application. So now let's talk about what type of mode and what type of a user you might be. First and foremost, if you have solar, you're either a net energy metering customer or you're not. Net energy metering means if I make one extra kilowatt hour today and I need an extra tomorrow, they offset and my bill would be zero. If you don't have that, you really want to get a Powerwall, because when you have excess solar, you charge the battery. And when you need that power, when the sun goes down, you have the battery. So in terms of lowering your bills, and if you don't have net energy metering, a Powerwall is a good idea. Second, maybe you have net energy metering, but it's a really crappy deal. And what I mean by that is if electricity costs you 20 cents when you use it, but when you give it to them, they give you 5 cents, that's not a really good deal. That means that you would have to give them 4 kilowatt hours to offset one that you would use later in the night. So if you have no net energy metering or a bad energy metering plan, a Powerwall can help you offset later energy usage when the sun goes down without involving the grid. The next question is if you're a time of use customer. Here in San Diego, we have time of use. 4 to 9 p.m. is really expensive. So what my Powerwall does is allows me to charge from solar all day, and then come 4 o'clock, it kicks in and tries to cut my usage in that peak period completely to zero. And what's really cool is because my solar system is still generating a little bit of electricity, I'm actually gonna get a negative bill in that period, because 4 o'clock usually is around -2 kilowatt hours, 5 o'clock is like -1, and then the sun goes down and I don't get much after that. But the Powerwall was powering the entire house in that entire period. So those are the different kinds of categorizations that you would have. But the bottom line is if you want to offset your energy usage, the Powerwall is an incredibly awesome way to do that. And if you're trying to make it an economic choice, time of use is really gonna be the key. If you can charge at an earlier time and discharge during the expensive time, the Powerwall will just pay for itself that much sooner. In solar, there is a huge important phenomenon called the duck curve. And what happens is in places like California, where we have high electricity prices and tons of solar, there's so much solar during the high noon period of time that the state of California is actually wasting it. There's way more solar generation than is needed. Isn't that crazy? Because we don't really have much in the way of battery banks and stuff. PG&E is working on a utility-sized Powerwall installation, which is great, but we don't have enough in the way of storage. So as a result, when the sun is shining, we don't need that electricity. And then at 4, 5, 6 p.m. when the sun is setting, we don't have enough. And then so the power plant operators have a huge challenge trying to figure out, when should we buy power, when should we not? Some power plants, called baseload power plants, are always on, nuclear, for example. Others are called peaker plants, and they can get turned on and off when the demand is high. These are the dirtiest types of energy, either natural gas or coal or something like that, and they are very expensive as well. And if we all have power walls and we distribute our energy creation and storage, we would not need peaker power plants. And that is the environmental benefit of the Powerwall. All right, now let's talk about the Tesla installation experience. First of all, they'll send you emails, ask you to take photos of your electric panel, where you want to install it. You have the choice of installing it in your garage. If you live in a place with really hot or really cold weather, you might want to do that. Here in San Diego, the weather is pretty nice, and I didn't want to lose any storage room in my garage, so I chose outside. You submit the pictures and stuff, they'll schedule plans and meetings, they'll come out. For the first day, they took all of my panels and circuits over from my main panel to the new Tesla critical loads panel. That pretty much took an entire day. So the actual Tesla Powerwall hanging and installation happened on day two. So on day two, they came out, had the gateway all plugged up, they hung my Powerwall, and it was fully online and working. Day three, which happened about a week or two later, is when the permitting office came down, the representative from the city, and they opened up all the doors, checked everything, and I got my permit approved. Then the final thing would be Tesla will schedule a chance for you to come out, and if they had to cut drywall inside to access your circuits on the inside of the house, or if they had to drill into your stucco or your siding on the outside of the house, they'll come out and repair all that stuff. The only issue that I had was when I first had my system all installed, what I noticed was when the air conditioning kicked on, the Powerwall never even tried to match it. What I mean by that is the AC is not backed up, and I know that. If the power goes out, my AC will not work. Interestingly, because I have natural gas and the furnace is backed up, I can still get heating, which is pretty cool. But AC will not work, and I know that. But what I was thinking was the Powerwall can output 5,000 watts or 5 kilowatts instantaneously and continuously. So at 4 or 5 p.m., if the AC turned on, the Powerwall is actually capable of supporting that much power and keeping my house running and keeping my bill at zero. But it wasn't. It wasn't even aware of those loads. And so I called Tesla and I talked to them, and they came out, turned out they had made a mistake, and they were monitoring my critical loads panel, not my entire panel, right? The difference is the critical loads panel didn't have the double oven, the air conditioning, and the Tesla charger. They came out and put CTs on the entire panel. So now the Powerwall is monitoring my entire house usage. So if I turn on my air conditioning and my double oven and my car charging and I'm using 10,000, it can't do all of it, but it will eat up 5,000, and I'll only pay the difference, which is pretty awesome. I love my Powerwall. Every single day I know it's at full charge, and it is using the battery during the really expensive periods of time, and my bill is even lower than before. The one request I would have, and this isn't really to Tesla, would be to allow the Powerwall to charge on the grid, even if you have solar, at midnight. Because at midnight, I paid 9 cents, so I could charge my entire battery for about $1.30. Then instead of having to use up 13 kilowatts of solar during that period when it's 30 cents, I could send it back to the grid and get about $3 worth of credit. And then my battery would be fully charged for the 4 to 9 p.m. like it does now. Currently that is not supported, and it's because of my utility company. They don't want batteries charging on grid at earlier times and discharging. That might change, because really energy arbitrage is what we really need here in San Diego and in California in general and around the world. Storing electricity is the goal. So I think this will change, and when it does, I'm sure Tesla will have a software update in the future. So that is the Tesla Powerwall, one of the most amazing pieces of tech that I've ever bought. I know it's just a battery and hangs on your wall, but I find it utterly fascinating. And if you do too, and you're interested in going Tesla for solar and batteries, we would hugely appreciate it if you used our link. It helps you out, it helps us out, and it gives us more visibility with Tesla for future events and activities. So that pretty much wraps it up for us. Hit subscribe, like this video, share it with your friends if you found it useful, and special shout out to Tesla for sponsoring this video, and to all of our patrons on Patreon for supporting us as well. If you want to be a rockstar supporter of this show, consider supporting us on Patreon. I'm Ricky with Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.